Welcome to Barbell Logic Rewind.
Hey, Barbell Logic listeners, 2020 Matt here. Scott and I thought it would be a good idea when we recorded this podcast to, you know, record it on an airplane. Seemed like a good idea at the time. Now, for the re-release, we had our amazing podcast producer, Steven, work his magic to make the audio as good as possible, but it is still on an airplane. And so we know the audio quality falls short of our current standards and what you've come to expect from us. But that being said, I felt the content of this podcast was important enough to re-release it with this series. So I hope you enjoy and just think about how funny it was to see probably Scott and I sitting next to each other holding the old Baptist church microphones on an airplane recording a podcast surrounded by other people. So have fun with this episode.
We're on an airplane on our way to the East Coast, kind of the East Coast, steel country.
That's right. We left Tulsa and we're on the way to Charlotte right now. And we're on an American Airlines flight. We got the exit row. We couldn't get any first class, but that's okay.
They were booked, the first class. And so we just want to talk a little bit. One of the things I want to talk about is how to know when you're actually ready for intermediate or advanced programming. And I mean like late intermediate and advanced programming or even mid-intermediate. And I would argue that most people who think they're ready for intermediate and advanced programming aren't.
Yeah, we did an episode on how to stop fooling yourself about recovery or the truth about recovery.
Yeah.
And then we talked about the three questions in there. So that's a big, those are three big tools you can use to figure out if you're done with LP. But sometimes even those don't tell us the full story, right? Like I'll get a new client and he says, hey man, I'm done with LP and I need help with intermediate programming. And then we start working together and having to do three more weeks of LP.
Yeah, I just had a guy, Nick Hammer. So I'll shout out to Nick. Nick is an excellent lifter, for sure an advanced lifter. So he is definitely an advanced lifter, right?
He's got a cool name.
Yeah, Nick Hammer. Nick Hammer. The guy squats in excess of 600 pounds. He deadlifts almost 700 pounds. This is all raw, right? And this is in the USAPL has got the weird 105 kilo or whatever it is. Like he's like right. 231 or whatever that class is. And so
somebody over there has got,
yeah, somebody's
SARS.
Got tuberculosis on the plane. And so, you know, Nick came in, he was an excellent lifter, but he had some form issues. And so because he had form issues, what we did was we put him on LP and I put him on a 4-day split LP. So he did 2 upper body days and 2 lower body days and we LP'd him. And so he's still doing, he just did a set of 5 on his deadlift at 585.
Right. So like definitionally, he's not a novice.
No.
But he can still benefit in this situation from doing
novice
a little LP.
Programming. Yeah, that's exactly right. And then when I'm done with that, I'm not going to immediately put him on an 8-week or 12-week program. I'm going to continue to make gains for him weekly because I don't know if he's ever done that in his own training, right? I just started coaching him a few months ago. And so if he's never done weekly training, I'm going to continue to push that and manage his stress with weekly-based training so that the weight goes up every week. And when it can, it'll be every 2 weeks. And when it can't, we'll go to monthly and then eventually do that stuff. Now, the thing about him, because you can tell based on his weight, he can't be a novice, right? Nor is he an early intermediate. The guy's got excellent body awareness. I can watch his videos and make some changes, give him some cues. And he comes back the next session and he crushes them. I mean, he can do it exactly every single time.
So the guy's squatting 6.
Yeah.
And he weighs 108 kilos or whatever the heck it is. Like, there's no way he's a novice.
There's no way, right? He's not. And yet, he can still benefit.
But he's just using LP.
Yeah, and why is what it comes back again to that minimum effective dose for maximum return on investment. I can very quantifiably see with linear progression, novice-based programming, that he's getting better every session because the weight on the bar continues to go up while his form is getting better.
Okay, so in two respects, he's getting better. The weight
and the form. Yeah, exactly right. And so once I get to an 8-week program or a 12-week program, I really only have true quantifiable results at the end of that program.
When you peak him.
When I peak him, right? Which is probably going to be for a competition or a mock meet or whatever. But right now, I need a quicker feedback loop for him. Nearly every one of those people that have signed up who thought they weren't a novice, we put them on LP.
Yeah.
And we put them on LP, it just is going to be faster, right? So LP might last 3 weeks, might last a month. Just about every single person who thinks they're at one spot in their programming or in their training advancement, we almost always back them up a little bit. And then they then respond back to us, usually within 3 weeks or a month. They can't believe the progress that they made on this sort of training when they thought they were no longer a novice. And, you know, we've got little tricks that we use to kind of, you know, so we might change the rep scheme from 3 sets of 5 to 5 sets of 3. It's the same amount of volume, but we're able to continue to make the weight go up. We clean up little things with their form.
Putting Nick on a 4-day split.
Yep.
Of linear progression.
Yeah. I put him on a 4-day split linear progression instead of, I mean, you think about this, like a guy who's doing, so Nick's doing, you know, 365 for sets of five on bench press. and he's really never pressed. He's a powerlifter. So that's another thing. Right. For press, as strong as that guy is, he's definitely a novice.
Right.
So he just passed 200 pounds for his reps. Well, the guy's got a 400 pound bench press or an over 400 pound bench press, but he's only pressing 200 for reps. And so we're trying to bring it. As a matter of fact, every time he presses right now, does an upper body workout, he presses first. And bench press is second because we're trying to catch up his press. So
300's coming quick.
Yeah, so those are the kind of things that we do that we can actually continue to get people to make advancement in the most simple way possible.
Right.
So the first thing I would tell people is if you can make weekly progression, if you can add 5 pounds to your squat every Friday or 2.5 pounds every Friday to a lift, there's no reason to do an 8-week or 12-week program or 5 sets of 5 And it's not because any of those things are bad. They're not. They're actually great. Like the day is coming when you're going to have to do 4 sets of 5 or 5 sets of 5 or 6 sets of 5 or a 12-week program. But if we can make progress without doing those things, that would
sure
be
is
beneficial.
Nice.
Yeah. By the way, can you tell I'm getting a horse?
I can.
Todd, I've been at the seminar all weekend and did a bunch of lecturing and coaching. And I did the press platform. I coached a bunch, you know, I taught a bunch of lectures and the platforms this weekend. And by the end of that press platform, I was awfully raspy. I sounded like I've been smoking cigs for a while.
You know, I just recently had a form breakthrough, you know, and so when that happened, that sort of kicked off a round of LP for me. Like, we're like, oh God, some stuff clicked.
Yep.
You know, we can race ahead here. And so we did a little LP on my squat and
yeah, absolutely.
Added, 20 pounds or something to my 5 rep PR or something in a couple of weeks on the squat. And at this point in my game, that's, I don't know. That's probably what I did last year.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
And then I had a little form breakthrough and just super profitable.
Yeah, you back up. So, I mean, and we talk about this too. Like if you get sick or you go on vacation, and I just came back from a several week layoff from vacation and had some crazy business stuff going on. Ended up coming back in and doing LP. Well, I mean, I've trained for 25 years and I'm still going to LP for his works, right? Yeah, I'm old. But, you know, and then we also talk about training advancement is based on recovery. But if you're a 45-year-old guy, 50-year-old guy who thinks he's a advanced lifter and you're squatting 155 for your sets of five, you're not an advanced lifter. And so it doesn't mean something's wrong. It means something's wrong.
Yeah, so let's talk about that. People ask all the time, like social media, they're like, where should my weights be when I get out of LP?
Yeah.
Like I'm a dude.
Sure.
You know, what's normal? And of course, you know, I never really want to give them that answer. I never want to give them that answer, but I think we can give them some rules of thumb, though.
Sure.
I think we can say if you're a guy and you weigh over 150 pounds and you're not squatting 2.25, I mean, that's very conservatively.
Oh, that's
you can very conservatively say that you're not out of LP.
No, it would be really rare for me to have a guy that ends LP under 265.
275 is what I was thinking.
265, 275 on their sets of five on a squat.
I would say that would go up to about 50 years old. Almost anybody, almost any guy that doesn't have a birth defect. I'm not being funny there either. I mean, he literally doesn't have any health problems, no metabolic problems, hormonally normal, under 50 will get to 265, 275, 285 on LP.
Yep.
I'd say the middle of the bell curve gets to 305.
Yeah. No, I'd agree.
And some people will get to 375, 405.
Yeah, 400 pounds on a linear progression, which is going to require a body weight over 200 pounds for sure, is really, really good. Most guys end in the threes.
Yeah.
If you're skinny or you're old and you end between 250 and 300, that's perfectly okay. But if you're under 250 to 225, 250, you're under that, you're not a novice.
But that's the squat. So like presses almost any dude, any dude under 50 is going to get to like 115, I'd say.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's conservative, I would say. And so if your numbers are under that, if your deadlift's under 350 for sets of five, I would say conservatively, you're not done with LP. For ladies, I guess we should get some ladies' numbers, right? If they're not squatting 175, what do you think?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
I think ladies have a wider range of performance.
Yeah, they
actually
do.
Based on body weights and athleticism.
150 to 175 squat for sure for LP. Presses are really all over the place, right? Yeah. So I see a lot of women in their presses at like 65, 67 and a half. And you see other women that go right to 105, like no problem. So that's it would be hard to tell you a press number. Deadlifts, I mean, man, almost everybody can deadlift over 200 pounds as a female. Yeah. 200, 205, 225, somewhere in there. 225 would be good to end your LP on, but 200 pounds, 190 is pretty standard.
A diminutive lady might be 185, you know?
Of course.
And these are all people under 50. So that brings up something more about LP. You know, I've gone on about like, hey, you know, if you're 35, you're old in terms of this, right? You know?
Yep.
Well, if somebody's over 55, I often find, and they haven't been training very long, I often find that we just never get them out of LP, man.
Sure. Yeah.
Now, if somebody's been training for a long time, let's say they got started at age 40 and now they're 55, we'll get that person deep into some more complex training.
Yep.
But somebody that just got started at maybe age 54 or 56 or something like that, we're going to run LP for 2 or 3 months and they're going to get the flu or they're going to go on vacation or they're going to break their ankle.
Yeah, go see their grandkids for Christmas, right? Go on a cruise.
And then we're right back in it again.
Yeah, certainly there are a lot of middle-aged people who are, if they're consistent, if they're really consistent, we'll definitely get them into weekly-based programming, right? So we'll get them into kind of an old man Texas method or like a heavy light medium or something like that. But there are a lot of people that are 55 to 70 or 55 plus who will never get out of LP. And it's not, there's not even anything wrong with that, right? So I talk about Sybil all the time. Sybil's 82 years old. She trains pretty damn consistently. And I don't know if she'll ever get out of LP because there's still things like she goes to Oregon and she watches her grandkids for 10 days. Well, when she's out there, she either doesn't train or she'll go see Jordan Stanton, one of our coaches at SSOC, and she'll see him for one session. You know, she did a cruise on the Queen Mary. That was like 10 days. You know, she misses that.
And those are all good reasons to detrain.
Yeah, no, they're great. Although, yeah, they'll detrain. So there's detrain. And then she comes back and we got to back her off, you know, 15% and start running back up. And there's nothing wrong with that at all. As a matter of fact, you know, now that she's deadlifting right around 150 pounds and she's 82 years old, if I could just maintain 150 pound deadlift and until she dies, which will be like when she's 105 or 107, then, you know.
Or you die.
Yeah, or I die, she'll outlive me. You know, yeah, if, just imagine if you're a female in your 80s and you're deadlifting 135 or over, that's pretty strong for your age. It's probably strong enough for anything that life's going to throw at you at that age. And so, you know, she'll never do any sort of Texas method variant or heavy light medium. There's days where she doesn't feel very good.
Yeah.
And we start to train and I can tell like the real heavy set of fives just isn't there. And we'll do a lighter day and we'll just get a little more volume in if that's the case. But ultimately I don't need to periodize her and put her on any sort of advanced sort of program. And even though she's been training now for 2.5 years.
We probably need to unpack why that happens. The main reason that that happens is, we already alluded to it, is they detrain so quickly.
Yeah.
A 70-year-old person, a 60-year-old person, they miss 7 calendar days and they've detrained a little bit.
Yeah, you know, for sure.
A young guy, maybe he has to miss 12 or 14 days before we need to think about detraining.
Yeah, sometimes you'll miss 7 days if you're young and you actually get stronger because the fatigue dissipates, you know?
Yeah, but an older person, they miss 7 days and we're going to have to reset 5, 8, 10%, maybe, depending on how old they are, maybe more.
Yeah. Sure.
And then it takes them a longer time to make up 5, 8, 10%.
Yep.
You know, they're making
small
these
jumps,
ladies 1 pounds and 2 pounds jumps. It takes them a long time to get back. And then it's Christmas and they leave again. Sure. So here we go again.
Sure. Yeah. So certainly applies to an older population, right? Which again, we coach plenty of young people, but our wheelhouse are our middle-aged folks. And we've got a lot of old folks. And so if you're 25 or 32, this stuff doesn't really apply to you. You ought to be able to get yourself out of LP and then onto weekly programming and then so on and so forth. But if you're a middle-aged person or below and you haven't hit those strength numbers we're talking about, then there is a problem and we need to figure out what's going on to continue to drive your LP and make sure you're eating enough, make sure your form is correct. Again, form is a big one. If you don't have a coach, the form's jacked up, you're going to die quicker on the LP. The LP is going to die quicker. You're not going to die quicker,
right?
So, but for older populations, for these older populations, you have to understand, and that's who we coach.
Yeah, and not only is it who we coach, that's really who trains. Like, how many people are 29 years old and younger? Like, most of the population is over 30 years old.
Yeah, sure.
And so we don't have any stats to bear this out, but if you just think about it, I bet that the average person that's handling barbells or wants to get stronger, the average age is probably really, really close to 40.
Yeah, mid to upper 30s, I'd say. So if that's the case, and so if you think about what percentage of the people that we coach are middle age or over, it's like 80%, right? 80% of our clients.
Yeah. So here's my rant, everybody. I got to do it again. Life expectancy for me, I was born in 1974. I think the last time I looked was 76 years old. I'm supposed to be dead before I hit 77.
Yeah.
Divide that by two, 36.
Right.
That's middle age.
Yeah, that's right. So middle age is 35 and over.
Yeah.
What percentage of our people are 35 and over? Well,
most.
75 or 80% for sure. So if that's the case, then you've got some special population sort of programming variables that we've got to play with there. So it's not easy to get into an 8 to 12 week program if you're over 45. It's pretty rare, actually, that we see somebody doing like a block or a DUP or any of those. You know, even a program like that's not ours, like a Chico or a Smolov or any of that kind of stuff. All of those programs are fine. There's nothing wrong. Like, there's times when those programs are appropriate for the right demographic. The problem is that it's rarely right for somebody over 45. Even an advanced lifter is going to struggle with those sort of things because the recovery issues are such that they're dealing with things that younger people don't deal with. And a lot of times they're just dealing with life, right? There's just life happens and job career changes happen and divorces happen and your kids get married or graduate high school and it throws them off a little bit. And then we've got to make another run at LP. And so if I can make progress on LP, even after I have run an LP or even several LPs, and I come back from a break and run LP and make progress, I'm going to do that.
So easy.
If I can make progress on weekly programming, even though anybody that knows me know I'm an advanced lifter, I can't do weekly programming that long. But as long as I can do weekly programming and make progress, that's what I'm going to do. So then when I can't do that anymore, that's when I'll get to the point where I'm at doing 8 to 12 week programs. I start bringing in that volume, all those things that have to be done. And the program, the length of the workout goes from an hour and 20 minutes to 2.5 hours to 3 hours. So, you know,
the lady two rows in front of us just like tossed her baby up in the air, like playing with it and bounced the kid's head off the luggage.
Now the kid's crying in the background.
She's got a concussion. She bounced its soft spot off of the lights above her. Oh my God. Poor baby.
Yeah, the good news is that kid's got scholarships now for
American Airlines. Really love it when I can put a guy back in the linear progression. Because I said earlier, it's so easy. Well, it's really hard for them to do, but it's really easy to program and it's effective. And so we love it when we can do that.
I'd agree.
So we'll continue to do these programs about this more advanced programming, but we just keep having to issue these caveats that say, gosh, we're going to talk about this intermediate programming, but chances are you're not ready.
Yeah. Yeah, you need to know what's coming because I want you to see that box top of the puzzle so that you understand where your puzzle piece right now fits in. And for most of our listeners, they're going to be looking forward into the future to go like, okay, this is something I'm shooting for. I'll get here. But as long as I can make progress on the thing that's more simple or the thing that is a better minimum effective dose for that maximum return on investment, why would you do the more complicated?
Yeah.
You shouldn't.
The last point I want to make before we blog this completely to death is that this is what it's going to look like if you get hurt. This is what it's going to look like if you get sick. This is what it's going to look like when you go on vacation. You know, people worry about that. How do I come back? What are we going to do? Hey, coach, what's up? You know, I'm going to be in Costa Rica, and then I got filarial worms, and now I'm sick, and now I have Lyme disease. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to put you in LP until it doesn't work anymore.
Yep.
And good news is LP is simple. It's familiar for the lifter. They know what's expected, and then the next time you run it, and then the next time, and the next time, you always end up higher than you did the first trip.
Through. Yeah, exactly right.
So it's awesome.
Yeah, it's fun for sure. Yep, agreed.
So there is our first podcast from 30,000 feet. You know, Reynolds and I both run in businesses and live in different states, and we just got to record these when we can. He's getting ready to go to Hawaii and be gone for weeks and weeks, so we won't be able to record. So we're trying to get these in the can. So bear with us with this audio quality. We bought some good mics and got a pretty cool little travel rig here.
Yeah, there'll be some background noise. I'm sure they pull out as much as they can. But plus, it's cool that we're recording a podcast on an airplane.
That's right.
It's fun.
It's a dream come true.
That's right.